lives within us, so that we can show that light to others. Now we will be singing this song, 10,000 Reasons, many reasons to worship Him.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
you. 1 Corinthians 16, verses 13 and 14. I will be telling you that and giving you the word. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous and be strong. Do everything in love. And that summarizes it, and that's what people. Good morning. Precious Lord, giver of life, you've given us breath. You've given our lives meaning and hope. We thank you for your Son, Jesus. And as we gather here, it is for Jesus. It's because of him that we're here. We thank you for calling us yours, calling us your children, your people, your church. We lift up your word now, Lord. We ask that you give us the wisdom and the understanding and added courage to live your word. We pray for all those who are here this morning. Give their ears and their eyes the ability to understand. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning we're finishing our study. 32 weeks it's been. 32 weeks of study of 1 Corinthians. As we get near the end of a series, I always miss that book of the Bible for some reason. Even though I'm tired of it, time to move on, I still will miss that Bible chapter of the Bible. The passage this morning is really interesting. I think it's a great place to end and wrap up because Paul exhorts the church, just encourages them, exhorts them through his letters. And I think his exhorting the church in Corinth really applies to us today as well. Because my biggest concern, I have mentioned this before, but I think it's worth mentioning again, I do have concerns that we've kind of lost some of the passion. As a body, I'm speaking, we've lost some of the passion, some of the fire, the excitement for God. Our childlike awe. You know what I'm talking about? You know that moment when you go, and you get goosebumps, and you say, that's my God. He loves me so much. That time when you would see a brother or sister being baptized, and it would bring a tear to your eye. Very touching. I'm concerned that some of our joy has just faded away, has waned as a body. My observation, if you ask each other, I'm not going to ask individual people about your specific joy, has it waned or not? I'm not saying that. But I'm speaking as a body. When I look at the body, I do have concerns. We become tired, distracted, I think. Life itself kind of pulls us and causes us to feel that way. Feel overwhelmed on a daily basis. And what's sad is when we let that happen, it means we're not living to the maximum of what the Lord wants for us, for your life as individuals, but also for us as a body.
We're not really pursuing eternal things. I'm concerned for each of you. But again, I'm also concerned for the body, his people. Because I know God wants so much more. So much more for us here. We're not finished here. He's not finished. So Paul challenged the church here. I believe, and it fits us here this morning as well. It fit back then at Corinth, and it fits us. So again, we're going to look at verse 13 together. And there's no hidden insults meant to be with this picture or anything, okay? I don't want you to think, what's that about? It's just, I like the idea of just looking around, looking at things. Like a guard dog. Be watchful. Persevere. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. Watch. Another translation says, be alert. Wake up. Wake up. Pay attention. The first question you're wondering, maybe. Okay, so pay attention. Why? Why? Because our Christian lives, they're battles. Every day it's a battle. And if you don't see the battle, if you don't feel like you're struggling as a believer, then you need to ask yourselves, have I been living for Jesus or am I living for myself? Because anyone who's living for Jesus and forgets themselves, just focuses on him, they will experience battles within their spiritual lives. So Paul's concern here, the church there, they couldn't see the battle. They were just not recognizing it. They didn't see what was happening there. And I know we want to blame the culture today, blame it for everything. Blame the culture for what's happening out there in the world. But culture itself is not the enemy. I'll say that again. Culture itself is not the enemy. Our battle is with who? Ephesians chapter 6. Verse 12, it says, we fight against who? Rulers, authority, those in power, the dark world. So the real battle is against who? Satan and his followers, not the culture itself. They influence the culture, yes, but the culture itself is not our problem. Satan wants our souls. He wants our families. He wants our culture. And most importantly, he wants to destroy his church. That's Satan's goal. Satan wants to destroy his church. And we face real spiritual battles every day. And we must wake up and watch. Pay attention. Now, watching, what specifically are we to watch? First of all, we need to watch ourselves. Because our biggest problem begins where? With ourselves. It begins right here. Our hearts, our soul, our minds. That's the problem. That's the biggest problem we face. So watch your moral lives. Meaning, when nobody's around, when you're alone, nobody's there, watch your choices. Nobody's watching you. Nobody's watching your choices. Your decisions you make, how you spend your time, where you focus your energy and your mind, all of those things are battlegrounds. That's all part of the battlegrounds. And Satan wants to influence. He wants to persuade you and control you. And I have mentioned before, if you decide that my walk with the Lord, that I'm going to finish that strong. Several weeks ago we talked about that, finishing strong. you will finish strong. That means you will have continual faith, you will serve, you will love, practice that faith, grow within that faith as a believer. Watch ourselves. And secondly, we need to watch the enemy too. Be aware of what's happening out there. And it is exhausting. It can be exhausting. Because he cheats, he lies, he twists the truth constantly. And we constantly have to watch and go, wait, correct our children. Watch and say, no, tell friends what he's telling you is wrong. It's constant, a constant battle. For example, think about the word love. Think about the word love. How the Bible defines love. We spent 2 weeks ago on a Sunday talking about 1 Corinthians chapter 13, God's definition of love. Mentioned 1 John chapter 4, it talked about it there, what love looks like. But now we see how Satan, how he so expertly changed the meaning. Example, the LGBTQ community. Now I want to make a point before I go on here. The LGBTQ community is not the enemy. It is not, and I am not saying that. Satan manipulates those with people with lies. So for example, you're talking about love. Two people love each other. What's wrong with that? That's a good thing, right? And most people would say, yes, it's a good thing, and I agree. But as Christians, we must go back to the Bible and say, wait a minute. How they define love, that's not love. How they define love is not how God himself has already defined love. Because love begins where? With God. His character, his inclinations, his holiness. And then we have been created in his image. We are a people created in his image. We are not what we feel, what we think, what we believe, how we choose to live. We have been created by our Creator, God himself. We battle with that word love. Well, it's just one word, not a big deal, not a big thing. But it is. It is a big thing. Because that one word will influence how the culture understands marriage. One word will influence how the culture understands the word family. It will influence how the culture responds within schools. It's not just a word. The point is, we can't stop watching. We have to be alert. So then verse 13 says, we must stand, not that. It means to stand, to continue. Not just believe, well, I have faith, everything will work out, I have faith. No, that's not what it means. It's more than that. It means that we have to continually trust that God will give us what we need, which is right here, his word. God's plan for salvation throughout the Bible, all he wants for us to know, to live that holy, set-apart life from the world, it's right here. And it's his teaching. It's in this book for us. His love, his grace, his mercy, it's all for us. It's right there. So we need to go back. It's interesting. We need to go back and what we've studied all these weeks within 1 Corinthians, all the problems, the struggles, the challenges, the failures. Remember, there was a division, for example, a split within the church. Paul explains all those different things. For example, their behaviors were in conflict with the Lord. There was confusion, arguments about spiritual gifts. All of those things were happening. And why were they happening? Because the Bible, the authority, the church had diverged from that. They had decided that this, the Bible, did not have authority within their lives. Oh, some of it was fine, yeah, but the rest of it, some parts, I don't agree with that part, so they disregarded parts. But the Bible is the authority. We face the same problem today. The Bible must have the final authority for our lives, meaning what's here, what it says, that's it. You short yourself, mean I know, I obey, I will provide people with what's in here. This is how we live together. This is how we love together. Question is, if I believe, am I willing to submit? Again, the Bible is the authority. God's authority was given to us. It's right here. Am I willing to submit? Am I willing to obey? Am I willing to take the time to study what the Lord says here? I know, for example, we enjoy reading devotions, and I support that. I agree with that. I think it's great. It's helpful. A brief, superficial kind of thought-provoking devotion. Ooh, that kind of inspired me. I never thought about it. And colors your week. That's great. But that's not enough. We need to take time to study what the Lord has for us here. This helps us to become serious students, meaning helps us to build our lives, helps us to build our families, helps us to build our church. Want to know how to build families? You want to know how to build a life? The church? It's right here. The Lord has provided this for us. We have to really hold strong, stand strong to his word. And it's not popular today, I know that. So then Paul says in verse 13, we must be courageous. Courageous. Another translation says, you must act like a man. Act like a man. Act like an adult. Be strong. But what does that mean exactly? Act like a man, be strong. I remember when I was growing up, when I was young, I tended to cry a lot. I was a baby when I was young. Yep, it's true. And my brother used to kind of tease me constantly and pick on me and say, come on, grow up. You're a baby, grow up. That's what Paul means here. You need to grow up, get tough. That's not what Paul's saying. No, that's not what he means here. If you go back to when I started, we're tired. Some of us here are discouraged. We're distracted for sure. So Paul is saying you need to become courageous. He means where your spirit have spiritual strength. It's not like inside I'm a strong person, I'm a tough guy. But he's talking about spiritual strength. Stop acting like a child spiritually. If you remember back 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul wrote here, brothers and sisters, I couldn't talk with you as I do spiritual people. I had to talk as though you belonged to this world or as though you were infants in Christ. Spiritual infancy, he means. 5 years, that church was together 5 years. They were together 5 years together through worship, through Bible study, studying his word, thinking, believing, their actions, moral standards, their attitudes, and they hadn't changed. 5 years. And basically, they were the same people they started. Their understanding of sin and how to change, their desires, their passions for the Lord, nothing had changed. Wanting to pursue that holy life, that hadn't changed. And what was sad? The world, the community there still controlled how they thought, what they thought. It influenced their decisions as well because of fear. Now think about that. What would my family, what would my family think of me? What would my friends, my coworkers think of me? No. There's a more important question here, and that is, what would the Lord think of me? What would Jesus respond? How would he respond to my decisions? Would he give me a thumbs up or a thumbs down? And I'm wondering, when you look within yourself, look at the last 5 years, think about yourself 5 years ago, do you have more spiritual courage today than you did 5 years ago? It's an important question. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 29. Fearing people is a dangerous trap, but trusting the Lord means safety. Fearing people, the world, their perception, what are they going to think of me? If I do this, this, and this, what are the consequences going to be? All those fears, those are dangerous. It's a trap. And the question for us, do I fear the Lord alone? Do I trust the Lord alone? Do I trust him with my relationships with my spouse? Do I trust the Lord alone for how I raise my children? Or do I allow culture and allow my neighbor, my friends to influence me? And I change to try to fit with them. So verse 13 again, Paul says, be strong, become. The Greek word there, it's a passive verb, so mean become, you will become strengthened. You can't make ourselves stronger, spiritually strong. I've decided I'm going to become stronger. That doesn't work. I'm letting you know that does not work. It's his work. The Holy Spirit. Only the Holy Spirit can give us that courage that we need, and he provides that strength. He provides that courage. So whatever is going on out there in the world, whatever you face in your daily lives, whatever challenges or pains or frustrations or failures or disappointments, you can face them. You can. But you need to decide every day that I will trust and I will submit and I will obey. Amen. And Paul wraps it up in verse 14, his teaching here with, I think it's a very powerful command. He says, do everything with love, everything. Because of love. And specifically, your love for the Lord, your love for each other. Whatever you're doing, you do it because of love for him and for each other. And what that looks like, Paul gives us some examples here in this passage. So you can read that and then I'll sign it. Remember here, Paul is kind of summarizing this long letter. And he says, you know that Stephanas and his household were the first to harvest believers in Greece, and they are spending their lives in service to God's people. I urge you, dear brothers and sisters, to submit to them and others like them who serve with such devotion. I am very glad that Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Archaeus have come here. They have been providing the help you weren't here to give me. They have been a wonderful encouragement to me, as they have been to you. You must show your appreciation to all who serve so well. So first of all, because we love the Lord, we love each other, we will serve each other. Like this example, Stephanas and his family, verse 16, it says, they devoted themselves to serving. Devoted themselves. When I was studying this, I was curious. So I went to another translation and I looked King James Version. I don't use the King James Version normally, but I was just curious of that translation. And that said, they addicted themselves. That's kind of a negative word today, that word addicted. But the idea here is that their commitment for serving, they just couldn't help themselves. They were like hooked on doing it. They couldn't help it. They had to serve. They loved each other so much, they could not say no. Not serving? That wasn't even an option. They had to serve. Whatever it took, that's how much they loved God and they loved his people. Are any of you addicted to serving? And that made me think, one guy here that works at our church, FCOB Church at Large, Larry Fogle. Some of you may know him. He doesn't know I'm talking about him right now, but if he found out, he might not be happy with me. I don't know, but anyway, and he's a good guy. He retired from ministry. He was a pastor. He worked with me when I joined here. He was already here serving as a pastor for many years. And he went to another job within the larger church for a while, and then he retired. And then, just a short time after his retirement, he was back here serving again as a volunteer. And now today, he actually works on staff here again, and he works 30 hours a week, and he's our business administrator here for the church. And he's over 70 years old. I think that's right. Yeah, he's in his 70s. So why is he working here? He doesn't need the money. He does not need the money. He's retired, comfortable, everything's good. Why doesn't he spend the rest of his days playing golf? I know he loves golf. Why not? Because Larry understands verse 15. He serves because of his love for the Lord. He serves because of his love for his church. So secondly here, serve each other. Because we love each other, we will encourage each other. Encourage each other. Verse 17 and 18, it says, I'm glad, Paul says, I am glad Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Archaeus have come here because you were not here and they provided help that you couldn't. Wonderful encouragement for me, Paul says. And another translation says that they refreshed my spirit. Refreshed my spirit. You know people like that? You have people within your lives who refresh your spirit. You meet them, and just in an instant, you feel better. You feel good. They come into a room and just the mood changes just like that. It's better. more important question, I guess, is that you? Are you the person who refreshes other people? Wonderful encouragement. When you spend time with people, do they sense the joy, the peace, the love, your joy, peace, and love? And Paul says those people deserve recognition. But thank you. You know that your few comments, your words, really made a difference to me. Thank you. You have no idea how your encouragement changes a person. It makes their day better. It can change their life, actually, just like that. Show your appreciation for those people. Give them a hug. Tell them thank you. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for loving the Lord. Thank you for loving His church so much. The last example here of love in verse 20, it says, give each other affection. Give each other affection, verse 20. Greet each other with a holy kiss. Ew, really? It says that in the Bible? Yep, that's from the Bible. Greet each other with a holy kiss. And I know today, culturally, we're a little resistant to that, that physical contact with people who aren't family, who aren't very close friends, or kind of standoffish, shake a hand maybe, thumbs up to you, that's it. We're fearful that they will misunderstand, and I understand culture today is different. And yes, there are certain kinds of affection that are not appropriate, obviously, and I'm not talking about that. What's interesting, while I was studying this, the first century Greek and Roman culture, the kissing in public was not something they did. That was not really acceptable. So that's interesting that here Paul says, when he recommends this, it was in conflict with their culture. It was countercultural. He's telling the Christians, when you do something that they are not going to expect this, do something, they're going to look at you, they're going to be shocked, and go, wow, those people really care about each other. So you understand, the kiss itself is not the point. Oh, you're relieved, I know. The kiss itself is not the point here. Paul's emphasis here is the affection for each other. The holy kiss. The holy kiss. And I believe that is significant. That's an important key word here. Holy. Show and express your Christian love for a brother and a sister. Take down those barriers. Take them down. Help people feel like you belong here. You and I, we're worshiping the same Lord. We may have different backgrounds. We might disagree on things politically. We might disagree on a whole list of things. Our ideas about things could be very different. But I care for you because we worship the same Lord. In Christ, you and I are brothers and sisters. And I love you. And I have noticed too through the years, that phrase, I love you, becoming less and less acceptable. Especially if it's a man telling another man, I love you. I tell guys I love you. I say that. A little shock sometimes. You can tell in their expressions. They're not used to that, but I don't care. I tell them because it's the truth. I do love you. You are my brother. I love you because you're my sister. Who needs a holy kiss? A holy hug? Who needs encouragement? They need it from you today. Think about that. Who? Who can I encourage? I challenged you last week. Do you remember? You were here last week. Do you remember the challenge? I challenged 4 people, 2 people that don't know the Lord. How will you reach out to those 2 people? And then 2 people who know the Lord, how you will encourage those other 2 people. I hope this week you'll think about who you can encourage during this week. And again, your encouragement can change their lives. Sometimes we have no idea what's happening within a person's life. They look okay on the outside, they seem fine. Inside, they may be in total turmoil, a mess. You just don't know. Okay, the last word from Paul. I give my love to all of you who belong to Christ Jesus. Amen. You know, it's interesting. Paul wrote 13 letters in the New Testament. 13. This is just one. Corinthians. And he closes with love. Now, again, think about this. Think about the body. What they had been through, their experiences, their challenges, their failures and struggles, disappointments, all of those things. Meaning they had challenged Paul. They had made Paul's life difficult. If you read 2 Corinthians, you will notice this didn't end. But Paul says what to them? I love you. Sounds like a parent, right? Sometimes your children cause challenges to us, struggles, suffering. But we still say, I love you. I love you. Paul could say, I love you because Jesus loved him. With the Lord, he gave his love to me, so I will pass it on to you. He could have said that. Everlasting love. The same love that he offers to you. The same love that's offered to me. And I think when we look back, again, 32 weeks of studying this, I hope that you remember different things about what we studied, but really most importantly, I hope you remember just how much the Lord loves each one of you. How much the Lord loves us as a body. How much he has poured out his grace, his mercy, his kindness, his forgiveness on us as a body. May God bless us. One body, united through Jesus Christ.